Connex Resources. I'm Alexis. I've been working on the connectivity between the front end and the back end.
Hi, I'm Austin. I've been working on the front end.
And I'm Riley. I've been working on the back end of the project.
So Nix Resources is a fracking company here in North Dakota. The problem that they're having right now is they have a single dispatcher calling all of their crew members and essentially telling the crew members when and where they need to be for the next day for their shift. You can imagine this is a pretty ineffective system.
So obviously our solution is to try and streamline that process altogether. So that includes making different jobs, which is kind of like the main, like it'll be over a longer period of time at a specific location, and then breaking that down into more manageable shifts for people to be assigned to. We also want to implement a Kanban interface. This is something that our sponsor has been really excited about or been very interested in. This is a very visual way for us to show how shift assignment works. So, and we'll have a good example of that later. We also want to make the information easily reviewable based off different queries, especially for the dispatcher. We want them to be able to look at what's going on at a particular job site or maybe on a particular day. And we also want every single crew member to be able to look at all the different types of shifts that they're going to be having, they're going to be having over the course of the week. And of course, we want to automate things that we can. And the glaring obvious thing is right now the dispatcher has to text everybody individually. So we're using Nexmo to just completely automate that process. And if time permitting, we'd like to add a few restrictions just to prevent any sort of human error. So this includes, you know, we don't want to assign a pipe fitter to drive a truck who's not licensed to, and we don't want to assign a truck driver to maybe be a laborer because their skills won't be utilized properly.
One of our user types is the dispatcher. The job is to create shifts and jobs, and in addition, assign crew members to those jobs. And then in our system, they'll be able to easily send text messages to all the crew members.
So then from the crew member side, the very first step is to receive a text message from your dispatcher. In that text message is going to be a small description containing the start time, the end time, and the starting location, as well as a link to the shift page that has all of the shift assignments. That crew member will be able to see all of their shift assignments, as well as to confirm that they're going to be working. So we've been kind of tossing some pages at you, so here's a little diagram of what pages we actually have. The first page that a dispatcher will see is the dispatcher page. The dispatcher page has all of the current jobs for the company. If you click on a specific job, you're going to be going to the job page, which has all of the shifts relevant to that job. And then again, if you click on a specific shift, you're going to be given to the shift page or the shift assignment page. That page is going to contain all of the details for a specific shift, as well as where you can assign crew members to work for that shift.
Let's get started with talking about the front end. ASP.NET or Active Server pages are of course placed on the server. They work to generate our web pages. They're very useful because they're dynamic, which is a big leg up on HTML, which means that you don't have to reload the page. So a framework that we're using is Bootstrap. It helps make our pages look much better. While it is purely cosmetic, it does help improve our layouts by creating a special grid, which in some ways is superior to the HTML tables. When the dispatcher first logs in, this is the page they'll see. At the top, there are all the jobs currently in the system. In addition, they can create a new job, delete a job, or edit it. When they select a job, they'll go to the job page. At the top, of course, they have the details of the selected job. Here, they have all the current shifts associated with the job. In addition, they can create a new shift. So when they click a shift, they go to the shift page or the shift assignment page. Like the last time, they have the details at the top, and they have a pool of unselected crew on the left, a pool of crew selected for the shift on the right. We haven't been able to implement click and drag yet, so instead, we do it the way that if you click on a crew member, they'll pop over to being assigned or vice versa. And at the bottom, we have the button here where when you click it, it confirms that crew are associated with the shift. In addition, it sends text messages to all the crew. One of the influences of Bootstrap in here, you might be able to vaguely see a grid here. So for each row, there are multiple columns.
So currently, this is kind of a rough approximation of what we're looking for as far as for UI. This has all the different functionality that we wanted to implement. So it uses a link to communicate with our database and to pull information from it. And it also has NextMode, so it's able to actually like send out the text messages. However, this we haven't fully used the Bootstrap yet, and this is kind of a template of one of the pages that our sponsors expressed the most interest in making sure that we have down. This is kind of a basic view of what the Kanban interface is, or at least that's what we've been talking about. So on the far left-hand side, we see that there's the available crew for 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. for March 6th, or today. And then all the different shifts that are going on during that time. We also want to give the dispatcher a few different options. So maybe they only want to look at shifts at a particular job site. So that would also be an option that would be implemented for them to work with. So, for example, if we did want to actually assign somebody to another shift, we might look at delivery B, for example. Troy, one of the workers on there, might need somebody to help him unload the truck. So you could take and drag Jeff over to that column and then hit the confirm button, which would then send all the different text messages to the different crew members that are being assigned for that day. And that pretty much concludes the front-end portion. Now we're going to talk a little bit about the different tools that we've used to give it some functionality.
So we've been kind of talking about our magical button that sends text messages. The way that we're using that is through Nexmo. It's a service which provides us with a virtual phone number, and from that virtual phone number, we can send a message to a real phone number. This is the method that we're actually using inside. What it does is the URL path that you see there is just a string. The URL path contains an API key, which is from Nexmo, as well as our virtual phone number from Nexmo, and then a real phone number for a crew member. And then that URL path is kind of loaded behind the scenes. The user isn't redirected to a different page. The user stays on whatever page he or she is on. And then the URL path behind the scenes sends out the message. And as far as another form of connectivity that we have, we're using Link to connect our front end that Austin's been talking about to the server that Riley's going to be talking about in a bit. The way that it's working is we're using this Link to SQL data context object. That object is in our web config file, which means that it's accessible anywhere within our project. And since it's accessing our server directly, we're allowed to access any of the tables that are in there. So we have a table called job within our database, which has the attributes of name, description, start time, and end time. And then we can populate those on the spot, and then we can insert them right away into our server. And then, again, it's accessible almost instantaneously.
So moving into the back end of our project, we're currently using a Windows 2012 R2 server. Our sponsor really wanted a Windows server. And that our server does two things. It hosts our website, and it also hosts our database. We're using Microsoft's IIS, which is their Internet Information Services, which is kind of the basic layout they give you to set up an actual website. It also has a couple different plugins that we can use to run our ASP.NET application that we've been creating. It also provides some basic security, which we're not particularly familiar with, to prevent our page from being accessible by those that we don't want it to be accessed by. For the second portion, we have the database, which we use Microsoft SQL Server Management Studio, and if you've ever used that, it's extremely easy to use, and it's you pretty much just add the columns as you would like any other table, and that will create the actual script for you and implement it into the database. We've also set up a remote connection via Visual Studio. This really helps us with our development process. So if we ever do use Link and we try and add something to the database, we can see immediately whether or not it's actually successfully been added to the actual table. So as far as login and security goes for the different users on the website, we're using the user table, which we'll talk about here in just a little bit. And that just allows us to prevent certain users from using web pages we don't want them to have access to. So this is the ER diagram for our database currently. Right now, this works perfectly for what our primary goals are for the project, but it maybe doesn't get into some of the specifics with certain types of crew members, so you know the piper and the driver. It has a user type, which of course would be something along the lines of a dispatcher, maybe a web admin, or a crew member. And then it also has jobs, which again is kind of something that encompasses maybe 1 or 2 days, or maybe even as long as a month. And the shifts breaks that down into kind of assignable time frames that we can put crew members into. We're using that shift assignment table up in the right-hand corner just in order to assign multiple people to multiple shifts and also to have people working on multiple shifts and also multiple people working on the same shift, if that kind of makes sense.
So you haven't added things like a user being qualified to be a driver?
We have not added specialties yet.
No. This is kind of a crude, maybe higher level overview of how that actually works. So we have Jeff, for example, who's assigned to multiple shifts. But there's nothing that really restricts him from being assigned to multiple different types of jobs, maybe either on the same day or maybe over the course of the same week. Obviously, if they're like 100 miles apart, it's probably not a good idea to assign them to that. The only restriction right now that we really have for crew members is we don't want them to be assigned to two shifts during the same time. And that's kind of handled mostly by the way that Kanban interface works. Obviously, you can't make a copy when you're sliding somebody or clicking and dragging them. So yeah, that's kind of the general idea of how that works.
And then so far, we've been talking about a lot of our primary and our core goals for the project, but we do have some stretch goals for where our project can go in the future. A part of that is the specialties that you were asking about. We don't have it currently implemented, but that is where we can take the project. And then as well as trucks and trailers, which was suggested by our sponsors and our mentors. What that essentially is if we have a trailer that needs to be matched with a certain type of truck, and if they're in different locations as well, if we have a trailer in spot B and a truck in spot A, but they need to connect to each other, there's a certain order that a driver would need to go in, as well as having a specific type of driver who's eligible to make those connections.
All right, let's sum up what we've been talking about for the last 10 to 15 minutes. The problem they have right now is that the dispatcher has to contact every member of the crew, which will take a very long time as of now. Our solution is easier to use than the current one. It allows the dispatchers to create jobs and shifts and assign crew to the shifts, and most of all, it allows them to talk to all of the crew members with just a click of a button.
Are there any questions?
I had one. Is there anything in the UI where if you're creating a new shift, when it has the list of crew, where it will prune ones out from that list if they're already on a different shift, or?
Yeah, so the crew members that you see on that left column, those are only eligible crew members. So there is a constraint before they're even an option.
So when they're not eligible, that means they're already scheduled for something else, or?
Yeah. That's the only constraint that we have on there, or that we will have on there.
Is there a plan to, for example, put in controls of, I'm sure there's some sort of level of, say, they can only work so many hours or so many shifts in a row?
Right.
Is any of that?
When we talked to their sponsor, that hasn't been anything that they've really talked about, so it doesn't really seem to be a primary goal for them. Biggest issue is the fact that the dispatcher is using a lot of time just individually texting everybody, and they'd really like a way to make sure that everyone got the text message and confirm that they've actually read it, so that way when they show up to the job site, and 8 out of 9 people have confirmed their shift, they'll know that they'll actually be showing up. So that's one of the issues that they've talked about.
Just so I get a better feel, how many people are we talking about?
We're not entirely sure. We've kind of asked our sponsors a couple times, but again, we're not entirely sure how well we're going to be able to scale this. It might be 50, it might be 100. We haven't been able to get as straight of an answer out of them.
I'm thinking if you start getting into 100.
Right, or if there's 1,000 or something.
Or 1,000, then that's a whole different model that you might want to very seriously consider a first pass that automates simple things like let's take 90 of them, try to automatically assign them,
right,
and then we'll deal with things that we don't know quite how to do.
Could be a thing where it's you have 3 copies of the system and 3 different dispatchers tasked with here's the 100 people you deal with. Maybe that makes it manageable without.
It's not within the scope that we've been asked to cover yet, but it is a great idea for where we can continue.
Since this is, based on a database, do you guys have any ability to pull reports or anything like that to look at, say, the history, say they want to look at a worker who's been assigned to shift several times, maybe they want to check and see if they've shown up or something like that. Is that capability built in or?
Not yet.
Not currently, no.
Yeah, again, our sponsor and our mentor have mostly been focused on the mass texts and then the confirmations.
So we have 2 sprints left. Okay. So what's your goal for the next sprint?
So to the next sprint is to get, I mean, we already have most of the functionality of those pages that you saw earlier fully functional. So the next portion of that would probably be to clean up the UI, make it a little bit more Kanban-like. That nice column pattern that you saw from Riley, that would be in the next sprint.
With drag and drop?
With drag and drop, probably.
Yeah, we have a few Bootstrap templates that we're playing with right now. We just don't have anything that's like functional or that that is connected with what we have working on that rough version of it.
One other thing I had was, you guys showed a page initially where you were connecting available people and jobs, and then you showed a UI mockup after that.
Yeah.
That first page, is that something that's backbone, or is that staying there? Is that going away? Is that the dispatch page?
The first pages are what we currently have. And then the later one that you saw is what we aim to have later.
Okay.
So it's just kind of a, here's the bare bones UI in order to ensure the functionality is there.
Yeah.
And we'll make it look pretty later.
Yeah.
Okay.
Exactly.
Yeah. We figured the functionality was a lot more important than the image.
One question I had is there a way to sort of secure the request to Nexmo, or could some mischievous person figure out the URL that you're sending stuff to and basically start spamming people with text messages?
Yeah, we did learn a lesson pretty quickly with that one.
Did somebody try and do it even?
We had the URL in our JavaScript, and we had it there for about 5 minutes. As far as actually being on our server, we took it off right away, and it still went right through. The URL is now within our C#, so it's not visible if you inspect the image.
Mm-hmm.
So far, that's the only thing we have. We changed all of our variables in there, so they can't keep continuing using that URL.
I guess, is there something on the Nexmo side where it looks at who the redirect is coming from and it
won't
trust anyone outside of?
That I'm not sure as far as not allowing people to, but there is a record that they store, so for any day you can see which messages are being sent from who and to who. We did look at that right away as well.
Okay. I'm just wondering if you can just throw enough junk at their service and eventually it matches something and goes through.
Right.
Yep. Texting going to be in Sprint 3?
Yeah, it can be.
Sure.
I mean, the texting part actually is functional. Like, you know, if you click that button, everybody that's been assigned on that page that's in an instance in the database will get a text message sent to them.
Oh.
So, yeah, I mean, the main goal right now is cleaning things up to make it a bit more presentable and then start working on some of those restrictions. Talk about some of the querying things you're talking about, setting up those pages so the dispatchers can review up-and-coming information and possibly even previous information. However, you know, we haven't really, there's no option right now. They haven't even really talked about whether or not people have actually showed up to their job. You know, so if somebody is chronically unreliable, there's no way of necessarily being able to see that.
As far as your configuration file, you guys talked about it a bunch, or not a bunch, but you touched on it. Is that something that, say, an admin or something for any reason is going to have to modify in the future, or is that something that's built and static once you release the...
You're talking in the server, or...?
You're talking about the access to the server, like the connection string, using link? Is that what you're talking about?
The config file.
Yeah.
I don't really know. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And the other question I had was for the... after you brought up the big numbers, that was something that I thought about through your UI, and it's actually something we're dealing with on the project that my team's doing, is do you have any idea how you would like to clean up the UI if you have a lot of jobs or a lot of people, how to easily display that and show that in a manner that can be?
Right now, at least the way that it's set up, obviously you can see maybe three or four things nicely, but if you have 20 things, you're going to be scrolling, which is not an ideal way of handling that.
Right.
The only way that I can think of is making sure there's more restrictions, so that only a few, so you might only be able to look at a specific job on a certain day or during a certain shift time. That would be the only way to limit that. The reason why we've gone the way we have with it, with that particular UI, is because that has been one of the consistent things that they've kind of stressed to us that they would like to see, or some form of that. You know, so as far as maybe compressing it or making having more jobs be available on a singular page, that's kind of up to us. But yeah, that Trello view or that Kanban.
So basically, you're thinking you would filter it based on, okay, they could select a job and then only the available people for that job and that skill set would pop up, or like you said, a time frame, and then only the jobs that were applicable to this time frame would show up. And then
we've talked about maybe like for a drill job, you might need, you know, again, I don't know all the people that work on that particular, you know, but there might be a drill technician or something, or maybe you need a mechanical engineer on site and then a pipe fitter as well. So then if you use, let's say you do a drill job, those requirements that might need to be filled, or those certain things might always need to be on there. So the number of pipe fitters you might need on a certain job might vary, but you'll need a pipe fitter on that job, or you'll need a mechanical engineer on site to manage that. And that's kind of getting into like the complexity of this project can scale like exponentially, because they've also talked about, you know, having different types of trucks and trailers. If you're hauling frac sand or the fluid that's required for that, those are different types of licenses. Those are different types of trucks that you're going to need, and possibly even different types of license. I already said that. But so that kind of gets into a little bit of our secondary goal. We want to make sure that we have the functionality for it presented in such a way that's easy to view. And that includes things like the scaling problem as well. So if there is 1,000 people, you do not want to have to scroll through them.
So that's kind of why I was talking about the config file, because I was assuming part of the config file, maybe I'm wrong on this, was you define some of these specialties and
Sorry.
That's why I didn't know if they needed to edit.
You're talking about the table, sorry?
I'm talking about like how you're going to define specialties and the roles and what a job needs and things like that. I assume some of that was done in the config file, but maybe not.
That's mostly all in our servers. That would be in the table attributes.
Okay.
And the config file just has the connection.
Okay.
So I was trying to think through, if you're trying to scale and you say I have 1,000 people, things that were going through my mind, you might say, okay, what's the hardest to fill?
Right.
You know, who are the people that, you know, have the most critical skills? And you pull those out and you assign them first, because they might be able to do 3 or 4 things. It's the task they can do most critically, and then the next group, and then the next group. But that's maybe not the best way to do it either, because you might end up with a job that needs 14 people, and you've got all the hard-to-fill ones, but you don't have general laborers because they ended up assigned someplace else or something. So you might say, okay, well, no, let's prioritize jobs first. Which job do I complete first? And I think it's going to take some thought. The point is, think about scaling, because how you approach it is probably going to affect how you want to set things.